Harper Audio presents Over the Edge of the World, Magellan's Terrifying Circumnavigation of the Globe. Written and read by Laurence Bergreen. On September 6, 1522, a battered ship appeared on the horizon near the port of Sanlúcar de Barrameda, Spain. Her tattered sails flailed in the breeze, her rigging had rotted away, and storms had gouged her sides. A small pilot boat was dispatched to lead the strange ship over the reefs to the harbor. The vessel they were guiding into the harbor was operated by a skeleton crew of just 18 sailors and three captives, all of them severely malnourished. Their tongues were swollen and their bodies were covered with painful boils. Their captain was dead, as were the officers. Nearly the entire crew had perished. The pilot boat gradually coaxed the battered vessel past the natural hazards guarding the harbor. The ship, Victoria, slowly began to make her way along the Guadalquivir River to Seville, the city from which she had departed 3 years earlier. No one knew what had become of her since then. Victoria was a ship of mystery, and every gaunt face on her deck was filled with the dark secrets of a prolonged voyage to unknown lands. Despite the journey's hardships, Victoria and her diminished crew accomplished what no other ship had ever done, by sailing west until they reached the east, and then sailing on in the same direction. They had fulfilled an ambition as old as the human imagination, the first circumnavigation of the globe. 3 years earlier, Victoria had belonged to a fleet of five vessels with about 260 sailors, all under the command of Fernão de Magalhães, whom we know as Ferdinand Magellan. A Portuguese nobleman and navigator, he had left his homeland to sail for Spain with a charter to explore undiscovered parts of the world and claim them for the Spanish crown. The expedition he led was among the largest and best equipped in the Age of Discovery. Now Victoria and her ravaged crew were all that was left. Many had died in excruciating death, some from scurvy, others by torture, and a few by drowning. Worse, Magellan, the captain general, had been brutally killed. Despite her brave name, Victoria was not a ship of triumph. She was a vessel of desolation and anguish. And yet, what a story those few survivors had to tell, a tale of mutiny, of orgies on distant shores, and of the exploration of the entire globe. A story that changed the course of history and the way we look at the world. In the Age of Discovery, many expeditions ended in disaster and were quickly forgotten. Yet this one, despite the misfortunes that befell it, became the most important maritime voyage ever undertaken. This circumnavigation forever altered the Western world's ideas about cosmology, the study of the universe and our place in it, as well as geography. It demonstrated, among other things, that the Earth was round, that the Americas were not part of India, but were actually a separate continent, and that oceans covered most of the Earth's surface. The voyage conclusively demonstrated that the Earth is, after all, one world. But it also demonstrated that it was a world of unceasing conflict, both natural and human. The cost of these discoveries in terms of loss of life and suffering was greater than anyone could have anticipated at the start of the expedition. They had survived an expedition to the ends of the earth, but more than that, they had endured a voyage into the darkest recesses of the human soul. On June 7th, 1494, Pope Alexander VI divided the world in half, bestowing the western portion on Spain and the eastern on Portugal. Matters might have turned out differently if the pontiff had not been a Spaniard, Rodrigo de Borja, born near Valencia, but he was. Alexander VI was a rather secular pope, among the wealthiest and most ambitious men in Europe, fond of his many mistresses and his illegitimate offspring, and endowed with sufficient energy and ability to indulge his worldly passions. he brought the full weight of his authority to bear on the appeals of King Ferdinand and Queen Isabella, the Catholic monarchs of Spain, who had instituted the Inquisition in 1492 to purge Spain of Jews and Moors. Ferdinand and Isabella wanted the Pope's blessing to protect the recent discoveries made by Christopher Columbus, the Genoese navigator who claimed a new world for Spain. Portugal threatened to assert its own claim to the newly discovered lands, as did England and France. Ferdinand and Isabella implored Pope Alexander VI to support Spain's title to the New World. He responded by issuing solemn edicts establishing a line of demarcation between Spanish and Portuguese territories around the globe. The line extended from the North Pole to the South Pole. It was located 100 leagues, or about 400 miles, west of an obscure archipelago known as the Cape Verde Islands in the Atlantic Ocean off the coast of North Africa. Antonio and Bartolomeo da Noli, Genoese navigators sailing for Portugal, had discovered them in 1460, and ever since the islands had served as an outpost in the Portuguese slave trade. The papal bulls granted Spain exclusive rights west of the line. The Portuguese, naturally, were supposed to keep to the east, and if either kingdom happened to discover a land ruled by a Christian ruler, neither would be able to claim it. Rather than settling disputes, this arrangement touched off a furious race between the nations to claim new lands and to control the world's trade routes. The bickering over the line's location continued as diplomats convened in Tordesillas, Spain, to work out a compromise. In Tordesillas, the Spanish and Portuguese representatives agreed to abide by the idea of a papal division, which seemed to protect the interests of both parties. At the same time, the Portuguese prevailed on the Spanish representatives to move the line 270 leagues west. Now it lay at approximately 46 degrees 30 minutes west, according to modern calculations. This change placed the boundary roughly halfway between the Cape Verde Islands and the Caribbean island of Hispaniola. The new boundary gave the Portuguese ample access to the African continent by water and allowed them to claim the newly discovered land of Brazil. Pope Alexander VI was succeeded by Pope Julius II, who in 1506 agreed to the changes, and the Treaty of Tordesillas achieved its final form. The treaty created more problems than it solved. It was impossible to fix the line's location because cosmologists did not yet know how to determine longitude. The treaty also failed to specify whether the line of demarcation extended all the way around the globe or just bisected the Western Hemisphere. Finally, not much was known about the location of oceans and continents. Even if the world was round, the maps of 1494 depicted a very different planet from the one we know today. Emboldened by the Treaty of Tordesillas, Ferdinand and Isabella looked for ways to exploit the portion of the globe granted to Spain. Success proved elusive. Columbus's voyages to the New World all failed to find a water route to the Indies. A generation after Columbus, King Charles I resumed the quest to establish a Spanish global empire. He, or his advisors, recognized that the Indies could provide priceless merchandise, and the most precious commodity of all was spices. Spices have played an essential economic role in civilization since antiquity. Like oil today, the European quest for spices drove the world's economy and influenced global politics. Spices became inextricably intertwined with exploration, conquest, and imperialism. The mere mention of their names, white and black pepper, myrrh, frankincense, nutmeg, cinnamon, cassia, mace, and cloves, to name a few, evoked the wonders of the Orient and the mysterious East. Arab merchants traded in spices over land routes, reaching across Asia, and became adept at boosting prices by concealing the origins of the cinnamon, pepper, cloves, and nutmeg with which they enriched themselves. The merchants maintained a virtual monopoly by insisting these precious items came from Africa, when in fact they grew in various places in India and China, and especially throughout Southeast Asia. To protect their monopoly, Arab spice merchants invented all sorts of monsters and myths to conceal the ordinary process of harvesting spices. The spice trade was central to the Arab way of life. Arabs developed sophisticated methods of extracting essential oils from aromatic spices used for medical and other therapeutic purposes. During the Middle Ages, Arab knowledge of spices spread across Western Europe, where apothecaries developed a brisk trade in concoctions made from cloves, pepper, nutmeg, and mace. In a Europe starved for gold, spices became more valuable than ever, a major component of European economies. Despite the overwhelming importance of spices to their economy, Europeans remained dependent on Arab merchants for their supply. They knew the European climate could not sustain these exotic spices. In the 16th century, the Iberian Peninsula was far too cold, colder than it is now in the grip of the Little Ice Age, and too dry to cultivate cinnamon, cloves, and pepper. Under the traditional system, spices, along with damasks, diamonds, opiates, pearls, and other goods from Asia, reached Europe by slow, costly, and indirect routes over land and sea. Along the way, spices went through as many as 12 different hands, and every time they did, their prices shot up. The global spice trade underwent an upheaval in 1453, when Constantinople fell to the Turks. The time-honored overland spice routes between Asia and Europe were severed. The prospect of establishing a spice trade via an ocean route opened up new economic possibilities for any European nation able to master the seas. For those willing to assume the risks, the rewards were irresistible. The lure of spices impelled sober, cautious financiers to back highly risky expeditions to unknown parts of the globe and enticed young men to risk their lives. In Spain, the best and perhaps the only reason to risk going to sea was the prospect of getting rich in the Spice Islands, wherever they were. If a sailor devoted years of his life to getting there and back, and if he managed to bring home a small sack stuffed with spices, such as cloves or nutmeg, legitimately or not, he could live off the proceeds for the rest of his life. And a captain had a right to expect much more than that in the age of discovery. Not only vast riches and fame, but titles to pass on to his heirs and foreign lands to rule. Portugal was the first European nation to exploit the sea for spices and the global empire that went along with them. The quest began as early as 1419 when Prince Henry and his English wife, Philippa, established his court at Sagres, a stark outcropping of rock at the southernmost edge of Portugal. Known as Prince Henry the Navigator, he rarely went to sea himself. Instead, he inspired others to conquer the ocean. Portuguese ships faced obstacles so overwhelming, so shrouded in ignorance and superstition, that only extraordinarily confident and accomplished mariners dared to venture into the ocean sea, as the Atlantic Ocean was then known. When Prince Henry came to Sagres, Europeans knew little about the ocean beyond latitude 27 degrees north, marked by Cape Bojador in West Africa. It was believed that the waters south of this point teemed with monsters, that their storms made them too violent to navigate, and that inescapable fogs would envelop wayward ships. In the face of all these dangers, Prince Henry offered a bold reply: "You cannot find a peril so great that the hope of reward will not be greater." He attracted navigators, shipwrights, astronomers, pilots, cosmographers, and cartographers, both Christians and Jews, to the academy at Sagres, where they cooperated in the enterprise of exploring the world under Henry's direction. The ocean proved extremely hazardous. Prince Henry sent no less than 14 expeditions to Cape Bojador within 12 years, and they all failed. He convinced Gil Eanes, a Portuguese explorer, to try once more. And in 1434, Eanes finally accomplished what so many had said was impossible. He sailed safely past Cape Bojador. The following year, Eanes, together with Alfonso Gonzalves Baldaya, returned to Cape Bojador. Baldaya sailed further south and collected thousands of sealskins. This was the first commercial cargo brought back to Europe from that part of Africa. On subsequent voyages, Portuguese ships brought gold, animal hides, elephant tusks, and slaves. Every captain sponsored by Prince Henry was under orders to record the tides, the currents, and the winds, and to compile accurate charts of the coastlines. Voyage by voyage, these charts added to the Portuguese knowledge of the oceans and the world beyond the Iberian Peninsula. Portugal retained its ambition to wrest control of the Spice Islands trade from the Arabs into the 16th century, hoping to reach the Spice Islands. In pursuit of this goal,
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.